Clap your hands, all you peoples. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. For the Lord Most High is awesome, a great King over all the earth. Sing praise to God, sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth, sing praises with a psalm. God is the King over all the nation, God sits on his throne. Let us pray. You, O Lord, are God who reigns above all things. You, O Lord, are sovereign over all things. You, O Lord, are the King of kings. So, Father, we come, O Lord, in adoration. Lord, we come in reverence, O Father, for who you are. Lord, we come in worship with thanksgiving. Father, we lay aside every worry, every thought, O Lord. And Lord, that we come and, Lord, we come in reverence. Father, we pray that Lord, that you will speak to us this evening. Father, we come at this service to you. Father, we pray that, Lord, that each of us will once again taste your goodness. That once again, Lord, that we will experience you in tangible ways, O Father. Come, Lord Jesus, come and move in our midst this evening. We ask all of these things in the most holy and precious name we pray. Amen. Good evening. I hope you all are doing well, and what a joy it is to come together. Maybe even though in different homes, we come together in worship this evening. So as we worship God this evening, word comes to us from Joel chapter 2. And God calls us to his people to return to him with all their heart. Return, and in verse 13 of chapter 2 of Joel, he says, "Render your hearts and not your garments. Render to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love." This evening, I'm not sure, how things are with you. Perhaps you may be joyful, or maybe you may be filled with fear. But God is calling us to turn to him rather than focusing on the fear, rather than focusing on the situation at hand, rather than focusing on what we are lacking today. He calls us to turn to him, turn our hearts to him, all of our hearts. So this evening, even as we worship, I want to encourage you to worship along with us as we turn to him, as we return to our Lord, as we once again focus our eyes, our minds, our hearts to him. Let us worship.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I wanna see you. I wanna see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord Jesus. Open the eyes of my heart. I wanna see. I want to see you, to see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 to see you high lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
We sing, open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Lord, it's our prayer this evening.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Lord, we want to see you.
I want to see you.
To see you high.
To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Holy, 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 you are holy, 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 we worship. Holy, 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 I want to see you. Oh, holy, 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 I want to see you. Thousand times I fail, still your mercy remains. Should I stumble again, still I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all praise. Will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. My heart and my soul, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace, to love you from the inside out. Your will above all else, my purpose remains. The art of losing myself in bringing you praise. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. Yes, my heart. soul. I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out of my soul. Rise out, everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond all fame. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out of my soul. Cries out till the end, inside out of my soul, cries out,
Lord. Heavenly Father, this evening, Lord, we return to you. We return to the first love, O Lord Jesus. Thank you, Master, for loving us. Thank you, Father, that you continue to call us to yourself. Heavenly Father, we're sorry that, Lord Jesus, at times that, Lord, our eyes are blinded by the fear, our own independence, O Father. Father, today, Lord, we want to lean into you, Lord Jesus, as you call us to return to you with all our heart. Lord Jesus, we pray that, Lord, that you will open our eyes, O Father. Lord, to see the work of your hand, O Father, in our lives. Father, we believe, Lord Jesus, that even as we sing, even as you worship this evening, Father, you are already at work. Work of sustaining, and the work of redeeming your people. Work of opening our eyes, O Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, we come to you, Father. We thank you, Master. Heavenly Father, we pray that, Lord, that this evening that you will continue to sanctify us. That you, O Lord, will continue to, Lord, heal us, O Father. Because you are our everlasting Father. You are our everlasting God. We bless your name, O Lord Jesus, this evening.
Purify my heart. Let me be as gold and precious silver. Purify my heart. Let me be as gold, pure gold. Refine this fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my Master, ready to do. Come and purify my Lord. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin, and make me holy. Purify my heart, cleanse me from my sin. Deep within, refine as fire. My heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, my master, to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will, oh Lord, ready to do your will.
Refine us, fire, come, set our hearts ablaze. Refine us, fire, come, set our hearts ablaze. So refine us, fire, come, set our hearts ablaze. Refine us, fire, my heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set apart for you, my master, ready to do your will, oh Lord, we're ready to do your will.
The scripture says, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whoever you ask in my name, I will do it, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. These are the words of assurance. These are the words of the promise. Even as Jesus is going back to heaven, to the place where his Father lives, even as he says, because I am going to the Father, and he promises that whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. And also he assures that whoever believes in me, they will be able to do the works that Christ Jesus could do. And that's the great promise. Even as we believe in Christ Jesus, we can have that great strength, having that belief that we can do greater things with the strength of God. And the promise is that anything that we ask in his name, he is going to do it for us. And that's the promise. for all of us, even as we spend this time in prayer. Shall we all look to God in prayer? Our loving Heavenly Father, we praise you, we worship you, we adore your holy name at this hour, Lord. Thank you, Father, for giving us this privilege to draw near to your presence during this Passion Week days, that we can be with you, be in the fellowship of you. Thank you, Lord, for the assurance that comes to us from your scripture. Whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. Father, we pray you give us that faith, that belief, that we can continue to believe in you and receive that strength from you, that we will be able to do the greater things that you want us to do. Pray, Father, you will give us every strength and that deeper faith in Christ Jesus. We do thank you, Father, for the word of promise you have given to us, to say that if you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Yes, Lord, in this world, we are in greater needs. We want our prayers to be fulfilled, our needs to be fulfilled, our difficulties are to be resolved, and all our problems, we want to overcome it. We want to claim that promise today, Lord, for all those people who are undergoing a greater time of difficulties and want that such times would be resolved. We pray, Father, you will give us every strength even as we come unto you in prayer and claim this promise. Whatever you ask in prayer to me, you will do it. Yes, Lord, we pray that you will fulfill all our prayers, all our heartfelt desires that we want to bring before the throne of grace, seeking your promise and seeking that your word would be fulfilled in our lives. Help us, Lord, these days we also would look into our own hearts in all repentance. At times, Lord, we go astray from like a lost sheep. But we pray, Father, that you will always come after us and bring us back to the fold. Help us, Father, to realize our mistakes, to realize our sins, and realize that we have walked away from you and we have been disobedient to you, Lord. Pray that you will give us that heart of repentance always, that we come back to the fold, come back to you in faith, to enjoy the greater fellowship, a greater forgiveness that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Help us, Lord, during this Passion Week time, we come unto you in all repentance, seeking your forgiveness towards us, and you will revive us and giving us the clean heart and a righteous life. We do once again pray, Father, for the problem of the coronavirus the world is facing, and the world is in greater fear of this disease. We come unto you, Lord, in faith. Whenever we look unto you, you will bring the miracles into our lives, resolving everything that we are facing in this world. Pray, Father, you will give us a greater victory over this evil that is threatening the world. Pray, Father, you will guide and lead and give the wisdom to all the heads of the government who are at the helm of affairs and have to take the right kind of decision, that you will guide and lead them, Lord, that they will be able to take the decisions which will help the people to win over this disease and this virus. Pray, Father, you will control this disease spreading to many areas and many nations. You will protect the world and protect your people and protect the nations. We do ask, Lord, for your healing hand upon all those who have been suffering because of this virus, because of the many other kinds of sicknesses. Pray, Lord, you will raise them up and give them all the restoration that they need. We do pray, Father, you will restore this world back to normalcy. Even as the world is facing, it is also facing different kinds of problems. It may be the economic problem. It may be the hunger and poverty and the loss of jobs. Pray, Father, you will soon restore everything to your normal life, that we continue to live for you, glorify your mighty name, and we rejoice in Christ Jesus, who understands our needs, understands our problems, and gives us the needed solution. We thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers, and it is our prayer that soon we'll be able to see there's a greater victory won over this problem the world is facing. We do pray, Father, for the church you have given to us, the beautiful fellowship that we have here in Indiranagar Methodist Church. Pray, Father, for your blessings upon all the families, the individuals. Can you lead and guide them, Lord? Keep them in good health and strength. Help them to live in safety always. And we believe, Lord, you are the one who is taking care of our lives during this time. Especially, Lord, we commit all the children, all the senior citizens. Pray that, Lord, you'll be very close to them and protect them, Father. We do pray, Father, for those people who are undergoing many problems because of the seizure. Pray that, Lord, you will care for them, protect them, and provide to all their needs, Lord. We do thank you, Lord, once again for giving us the privilege to draw near to you during this Passion Week. Pray, Father, even as we meditate upon the God's word and different God's servants would share them, pray that, Lord, these words will take deeper roots in our hearts, that will revive us and renew us and help us to grow strong towards you. Pray, Father, you will bless us and bless these days for us. We want to commit each and every one of us and our needs into your mighty hands, Lord. Be with us, guide us, and lead us, Lord, that we can newly bring glory unto your name and draw ourselves and sit at the feet of the cross, remembering the great things you have done to the entire world upon the cross. We want to thank you and praise you. We ask this in the most holy and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Today's meditation on Jesus and Peter. And even as we start our meditation, shall we look to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we humble ourselves. We look to you, Jesus, and we sit at your feet, Lord, because we want to learn from you, Lord. Lord, teach us, encourage us, correct us in love, and empower us, Lord, and restore us to you, dear Jesus. Father, we pray and commit and submit each one of us and, Lord, this message into your hands, that you will bless this time of meditation, that you will take absolute control, Father, and you will talk to each one of us, and Lord, you will draw us close to you this evening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For our meditation this evening, please turn with me to the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 22, verses 54 to 62. St. Luke, chapter 22, verses from 54 to 62. Peter disowns Jesus. Then seizing him, they led him away and took him into the house of the high priest. Peter followed at a distance. But when they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and had sat down together, Peter sat down with them. A servant girl saw him seated there in the firelight. She looked closely at him and said, "This man was with him." But he denied it. "Woman, I don't know him," he said. A little later, someone else saw him and said, "You also are one of them." "Man, I am not," Peter replied. About an hour later, another asserted, "Certainly this fellow was with him, for he is a Galilean." Peter replied, "Man, I don't know what you're talking about." Just as he was speaking, the rooster crowed. The Lord turned and looked straight at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word the Lord had spoken to him, "Before the rooster crows today, you will disown me three times." And he went outside and wept bitterly. Here ends the reading. As we look at Peter's denial, we see that all the four gospel writers, they talk about the denial of Jesus. And even as we have come to this point, and as we meditate on Peter's denial, shall we go back to what happened just before that? At the start of the evening, we see that Jesus is seated with his disciples. If you will turn to John chapter 13 talks about the Passover meal. And as Jesus is having his meal with the disciples, he gets up to wash their feet. And if you see John 13:6, he comes to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You do not really realize now what I am doing, but later you will understand." "No," said Peter, "you shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no part with me." "Then, Lord," Simon Peter replied, "not just my feet, but my hands and my head as well." After this, we see what else happens to Peter that evening. After this, we see Jesus talks about his sacrifice. We have the first, the communion being introduced as Jesus takes the bread and wine in his hand and talks about the suffering that lays ahead and the significance of the communion. So that itself was such a wonderful evening, isn't it? With Jesus at the communion, what can be more amazing? And during the course of that evening, we see in Luke 22, if we turn to verse 31, Jesus says, "Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers." Okay? Now here we see that Luke talks about Satan's role in the temptation that Peter faced. Jesus said to Peter, "Satan has desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat." Sift you as wheat is to bring ruin or to pick you to pieces or tear you apart. And we see that this is what Satan does. Aggressively turns against Jesus' followers because he wants to take us away from God, from our faith, from the plan that the Lord has in our lives. And that's why in 1 Peter 5:8, Peter warns the believers. He says, "The adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." And that's how the lion attacks in its natural habitat, isn't it? It waits to, or its prey, to see who is vulnerable, who is weak, and then he attacks. And that's the same that happens to us. If you turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 onwards, talks about, he says, "Put on the full, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand." And that's what's going to help us to stand, to put on the full armor of God. And For that, please read Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 onwards, 10 to 19 or 18. You can read to find out about the armor of God. And especially verse 16 says, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And our faith, how do we strengthen our faith? It is through the word of God, that we need to wait upon this word. Yeah, even as now we face the coronavirus, a lot of us have been talking about Psalm 91. It's not a mantra, it's just that we take it, we take the promises and we gain strength to face each day as we go, especially with this lockdown. And we need that strength and that confidence to know that God is with us. And it's His word and His promises that strengthen you and me and helps us to face each day. And also here, when we see, when Jesus says, tells him that Satan has asked to sift you, we also know that God knows what's going to happen in each one of our lives, each day. So that again gives us the confidence that, you know, God is with us. And when we turn to Him, when we hold on to Him, we know we can live in victory each day. Now what happens after that? We see that they sing a hymn. We will see that after the Passover meal, they sing a hymn, and Jesus and His followers, it's recorded here in Luke 22:39, coming out, He went to the Mount of Olives as He was accustomed, and His disciples also followed Him. Now what happens at the Garden of Gethsemane? Luke 22:40-46 gives us an account of what happens. And we see here, Jesus tells them, when He came to the place, He said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. Okay? And He later says, and when He comes back, Jesus tells them to watch and pray. He goes to pray, and when He comes back, He finds them asleep. And He says, why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation. We see that Peter does not give heed to this. He sleeps, and by the time the soldiers come to attack or to capture Jesus, now it's too late to get up and pray for strength, isn't it? And that is what God wants each one of us to do. Every day spend time in His word. No matter how busy we are, a few moments at least in the morning, take time to wait upon Him, to commit our day into Him and meditate on His word, draw strength, and take all our worries to Him in prayer. Because Satan tries to pull us down with the various trials, temptations, and worries. But God will always, He wants to establish us in Him. And He wants to help us live a victorious life. Yeah. And we find that most of the time when we have troubles, sometimes it's very difficult to pray, isn't it? But we need to learn from Jesus that in the most trying times, Jesus always increased His prayer time. So sometimes when we sit at the Lord's feet, a tear is enough. Isn't it? A tear says it all. But all we need to do is take time, sit at His feet, and bring our cares and worries. And that gives us the strength to face all that that enemy may bring to us each day in our lives. Okay. And from there, we go on, we move on. Now the narrative continues to the section of Luke 22, verses 47 to 54. We see how Judas betrays Jesus, and by leading the Roman soldiers to the Garden of Gethsemane. And then Jesus was led to the Jewish high priest's house for a hearing. And most of the disciples have fled when Jesus is taken from the Garden of Gethsemane. But Peter followed afar. He followed, but he stayed at a distance. Verse 54. Not long afterwards, Peter finds himself in the courtyard of the high priest's house. And as he sits there, we read in our portion how each time that he's recognized, but each time how he denies the Lord. Each time when he's questioned, he denies being with Jesus in 57, and then he denies being one of His followers in 58, verse 58. And thirdly, he fiercely denies even knowing Jesus in verse 60. Okay, and we see in the latter part of verse 60 that as he denies Jesus, and when he's talking, the rooster crows. And verse 61 says, the Lord turned and looked upon Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how He had said to him, before the cock crows, thou shalt deny me three times. Jesus, at that moment of Peter's third denial, turned and looked straight at Jesus. Now that look would not have been a look of, I told you so. It surely would have been a look of love and forgiveness, and that is what broke Peter's heart. Okay? And there's so much we can learn from that look. Okay? We can take away that Jesus is always watching over you and me, and he's in control of every situation of our lives. We can go back to Peter and the disciples in that fishing boat, in that mighty big storm, and Jesus was on the mountain praying. But when Jesus saw that the disciples were in trouble, he comes walking on the water. And at the Lord's command, we see that Peter actually walks on the water, and he only, when he looks at the waves, does he sink. But the Lord reaches out and pulls him up. Even today, Jesus' nail-pierced hands is there for you and me. As long as we keep our eyes on the Lord, we know that we have the strength and the confidence. But the moment we look around us, even today in the present circumstances, fear engulfs us. So many doubts come into our minds. But can we, even at this point, just look at Jesus? Can we say it aloud maybe in our hearts and say, yes, Lord, yes, this lockdown is there. I'm worried. We are all worried about jobs, money, future, what the future holds. But in all that, Father, we know that you're in control. Can we say it again and reassure ourselves that the Lord who saw the disciples in the water came and helped pull them up. The same Lord reaches out his nail-pierced hands to you and me and says, I'm there, and he holds on to us. And then we see the same when Peter is in the courtyard of Caiaphas. Jesus is in control. Jesus is facing his trial, but he turns around and looks at Peter. He knows what Peter has done. And he wants to tell Peter, you're not alone. Jesus reminds him that he has prayed for him. That look will talk so many things to him. That look of love that, you know, even when we sin or we fail, that look tells us that he doesn't give up on us, encourages us to hold on to Jesus. Yeah. And it's so amazing that even though Jesus is, you know, facing his trial, he's aware of what Peter is going through physically and spiritually. And it's a confidence he gives us that he is in touch with our lives. No matter what you and I do, Jesus' eyes are upon us always. And when we face trials, now children, so many of us, the children, the exams are postponed. So many entrance exams to be done. What about the future? It's a worry, isn't it? In the children's heart, parents' hearts. People are worried about jobs, salaries. Do we retain the jobs? What happens after this lockdown? How long will this go on? What are we to do? So many doubts, so many worries. We know there are so many expectant mothers, so anxious. Yes, so many people, they had big plans for the future, but suddenly everything has come crashing down and we don't know what to do. But this is the point. When we don't know what to do is where the Lord says, turn to me. I'm there. I'm watching. And I'm in control of every situation. And can we draw strength from that? Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. So let us come to his throne of grace, because Jesus is always living to intercede for us. He is always watching, always praying, and always with us. And what an amazing thought, and what a strength, isn't it, to know that this God is always with us. Yeah, and as the song says, his eye is on the sparrow, and his eye is surely upon you and me at this point. Now coming back to Peter, just imagine how he must have been feeling. You know, it started out as such a wonderful evening, isn't it? Amazing evening. And now he's at the lowest point of his life. And at this point, it's not looking good for Peter. But then, it certainly didn't look like that at times for Moses, Rahab, David, Gideon, isn't it? But God did not give up. But in spite of their faults and failures, he used them. And he is going to use Peter, and he's going to use you and me. So let not our faults or our setbacks keep, you know, say that we will not go forward. But all we need to do is not run away from the Lord, but run into his hands and wait for him to fulfill his plan and purposes in our lives. Okay? God does not want us to give up at any point. Yeah, we find that we sin. We sin, and when we sin, we deny the Lord just as Peter did. Yeah? And we can't actually see the Lord turn and look at us, but we know that he still feels the same. Okay? But what can we do is we can go back to the Lord and repent. Just like Peter did, we can repent. And what does it say? That how does Jesus respond to our sin when we repent and confess? He is our advocate and lawyer who pleads on our behalf. 1 John 2:1-2. To the Father, he pleads for us, and also he remembers our sins no more. Hebrews 8:12. So don't let the enemy get us down saying, you've done this, there's no hope for you. No, there's always hope. Let's return and come back. If we have never accepted the Lord Jesus, maybe this is the time to say, Lord, come and be the Lord of my life. I'm tired, Lord. I can't carry this burden anymore. Can we look to him? Or if we have backslidden because saying, Lord, I have sinned, I can't come back. No, there is no pit too deep that he will not reach out and bring us to him. So shall we turn and come back to him today? Wherever we find ourselves, come back to the Lord. And those of us who are at his feet, be strengthened that he never gives up on us. Yeah. And this point he reminds us that when we go through the waters, they will not drown us, nor the fire burn us. Whatever we are going through today, he is there to hold us by our hand and lead us to victory. Yeah? And that is how, you see, Peter's story does not end with that denial and his weeping. We see in John 21:1-23, if you read, the Lord comes on the shore while Peter and the disciples are fishing, and we see that they have caught nothing. But at the Lord's command, we see that they put down their nets and they catch fish. Now, isn't this exactly what happened in the beginning when the Lord came to Peter? Yeah, at Jesus' command, Peter takes the boat into the water and he lets down the net. He has a catch of fish, and here again, the same happens. You see, God's plan and purpose for our lives doesn't change. We may deviate here and there, but when we come, he brings us back to him and he fulfills what he has planned in your life and my life. Now, when they have this catch of fish, we see that they recognize it's Jesus. And what does Peter do? True to himself, he dives into the water and he comes to the shore. And when they come to the shore, the disciples find that there's a fire lit and there's fish and there's breakfast being made for them. And now this coal of fire in John 21:9 must have reminded Peter of that coal of fire in the courtyard, isn't it? How he denied the Lord. And here by this fire, again we see that the Lord asks Peter thrice, do you love me? And thrice Peter says, I love you, Lord. What an amazing Savior. He invites Peter to sit and eat because he wants him to be his friend. Yeah. And when Jesus talks to Peter, it is so clear that it's as if the Lord is saying, your mistakes in the past, yeah, they were sad mistakes, but that was yesterday. Now you must take your eyes from yesterday and focus them on tomorrow. Tomorrow there will be multitudes that need to hear the word of God. So what does he say? He says, feed my lamb, tend my sheep, and feed my sheep. And this is the reassurance that Peter needed, that he was back, isn't it? And we see the same Peter when he was filled with the Holy Spirit a few weeks later. He preaches amazing and powerful sermons. The first message that he preached was on the day of Pentecost. He declared to a crowd that Jesus is the Messiah. 3,000 people were converted. Second, after God healed the lame man in Solomon's portico, Peter preached a sermon of repentance and 5,000 people were saved. Third, after Peter and John were arrested and brought before the high priest, Peter bravely defended his faith in Christ and told the elders, there is salvation in no one else. Acts 4:12. Amazing. Three denials, three affirmations of Christ's love, three courageous sermons defending Jesus in the face of opposition. Dear friends, there's a bit of Peter